Found you in Wyoming.
Part of the magic of bushcraft is just coming out and looking around, getting to grips with the environment, seeing what the potential is. Just down here, there are lots of fish rising, there are cutthroats in there. And it doesn't mean to say that we have to come always and catch them. It's about enjoying the fact that they're there, looking at the real potential of the landscape. It brings us very close to nature in a way that no other outdoor pursuit can.
This is always the best time of day to explore an area. Before the sun gets too high in the sky, you've got much more chance of seeing wild animals.
What a beautiful sight. Bighorn sheep in their natural environment. And it's quite interesting because in this part of the world, the Shoshone here were often called sheep eaters. One of the things that they used to use the sheep for was making bows. The males have massive horns that come right up and curl around, and they would cut out a tapering strip from each horn, which they could then straighten out, glue together, and back with sinews, with tendons, to make an incredibly powerful bow. There are even accounts of Indians riding alongside a buffalo and shooting an adult with this bow, and the arrow passing clean through the adult and killing a calf alongside. It gives you some idea of how powerful they were.
The Shoshone that lived here had a very special relationship with their environment. They valued the resources that Mother Earth provided and tried always to take only what they needed from the land.
Well, this jerky looks quite good now.
It sure does.
What do you think? Time to pack it away?
Yeah, I think so. I think we should start.
I'll tell you what, with that wind coming, it makes me think winter's nearly here, isn't it? I'm going to try a little bit of this jerky because it's looking really good.
Oh, that's fantastic. And then when it gets a little bit drier, you know, we could put it up on your rack like you have here, and we'll build another fire, and we'll use maybe some aspen or different types of flavoring and flavor it a little bit.
Well, I mean, this tastes better than anything you can buy. This beautiful flavor of the smoke there, I mean, that's great.
It is.
Oh, it tastes so good.
I wished I put a little bit more salt on it.
Oh, I don't know. I like it. That's excellent. Really nice. And how long would they keep that for them?
Oh, this would, they would keep this all winter long.
Fantastic.
Just have to force it down in these.
What's that bag made out of then?
This is made out of elk feet.
That's beautiful.
I wish we had a chance to bring one up. We could have made one for you.
That would have been nice to see.
Maybe in the next time.
Another time, Leah.
Another time, yeah.
I'm back on Jim Bridger's trail. Not long ago, he would have relied upon the hospitality of the Shoshone to find a path through these mountains. It's ironic that opening these paths to the wagon trains nearly brought about the demise of the very people who had shown the way. Over 65 million bison or buffalo once roamed this country. A massive extermination of the species was launched in order to destroy the native peoples who depended upon them. By 1900, only a handful of wild buffalo remained.
Fortunately, not all the bison in America were killed in the great culls. There are still herds to be seen today. But sadly, we can only wonder at the sight of a herd so big you could ride all day on a fast horse and never get to the head of it.
The tribes knew the routes and patterns of migrating animals, setting strategic hunting camps in the same places every year. There are still signs of the people who were displaced. These stones were used to hold down the outside of a teepee.
This is one of 20 or more sites like this just on this ridge here on Table Mountain. And what these are believed to represent are the stones left where a tent was erected by native people here probably in the winter, because they tend to have rather deep fire pits in the middle of them. What we do know is that this area here was and still is a migration route for many wild species. So it could well be that this was a site, or maybe a winter encampment, of hunters intercepting those animals. There are other more mysterious signs. This ring of stones here, in one expert's opinion, would once have been a stone wall that stood maybe this high in a circle. It was an eagle trap. And inside this, a young man would hide, hidden by sticks and grasses put across the top, on top of which would be a dead animal. When an eagle came down to get it, he'd reach up and grasp it by its talons, and then he could pull out the feathers from the bird for ceremonial use and then release it.
They lived in balance with their environment and respected men like Jim Bridger for adhering to the same ideals. For generations, Native Americans had traveled this continent, finding the best routes and passing that knowledge from clan to clan. It was they who, in the middle of the 19th century, showed Jim Bridger and the mountain men the easiest way to cross the Rocky Mountains. In doing so, they unlocked the route to the Pacific for the pioneers, a place called South Pass. It was the key to the westward migration and the expansion of America. Without it, wagon travel across the continent would have been impossible.
I don't think it would do any good to try and thumb a lift on this road. There hasn't been much traffic through here for a long while. But for a short period in American history, this was one of the busiest roads on the continent. 500,000 people came along here, heading west in search of brighter futures. In fact, the last wagon came past in 1912, which somehow just seems like yesterday. I guess this route through the mountains will always be associated with the mountain man, Jim Bridger, because he's the man credited with pioneering it. But it was, in fact, the Indians who showed him the way. What I think is important is the wisdom of that old mountain man. He knew the value of respect. He showed the Indians respect, and in return, they respected him.
Little Britain next here on BBC Two, and over on BBC Four. Archive footage combines with diary extracts to provide an insight into Hitler's propaganda minister. Dr. Goebbels speaks starting now. And Ray Mears has written a book to accompany his bushcraft series with detailed information on survival techniques from cultures around the globe.